Happy Easter, everyone, and welcome to the Higley Manor Ward. It's so good to see all of you, and a special welcome to any visitors that we might have in the congregation today. President Wallen from the stake presidency will be presiding in this meeting, and I'm Elliot Bagley. We express gratitude to Sister Tammy Johnson and Jeff Pendleton for providing the music today. We have a number of announcements. Looking over them, none of them are that Christ rose from the grave, but I'm hoping that our speakers will cover that announcement today. There is a single adult family home evening on Monday, April 8th in the Williams home, but not the Williams in our ward. There's a stake primary activity on April 20th, and the start times vary depending on the age of your child, but the first start is at 9 a.m. and that's in the Maplewood building. Also this week there was a email sent out both from the stake and from the ward with a link to where you can submit questions for state conference. And so if any of you have questions you want to submit, we encourage you to do that. And also I've got the letter to read for state conference. Dear brothers and sisters, the semi-annual state conference of the Gilbert, Arizona, Williamsfield Stake will be held on Saturday, April 13th and Sunday, April 14th, 2024. Elder Mark A. Godfredson, an Area Authority 70, will preside. We encourage you to prepare to receive the instruction our Heavenly Father and His Son Jesus Christ have for us at this time. The conference will consist of three sessions. Saturday evening session will be held on Saturday, April 13th at 6 p.m. here in the Stake Center. All adult members and friends in our stake boundaries are invited to participate. All are invited to attend in person, subject to available seating in the Stake Center. For those who cannot attend at Stake Center, this session will also be broadcast on the Stake YouTube channel. There's also a ward and stake council leadership meeting that will be held on Sunday the 14th at 7 a.m. There are several people invited. We will reach out to those individuals so that you know if you're supposed to come or not. The general session of state conference will be held on Sunday, April 14th at 10 a.m. here at the Stake Center. All members and friends in our stake boundaries are invited to participate. All are invited to attend in person, subject to available seating in the Stake Center. For those who cannot attend at the Stake Center, the session will also be broadcast on the Stake YouTube channel. Brothers and sisters, we love and appreciate each of you and know we will be spiritually blessed during this conference. In preparation for this conference, we invite you and your families to reach out to those who are assigned to minister. As a stake presidency, we feel strongly that your preparations will contribute to strengthening your spiritual foundations. We know the Lord's promised blessings will be upon you and your family as you exercise faith and diligently follow our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Sincerely, the Stake Presidency. We will begin our services by singing hymn number 200, Christ the Lord is Risen, and Piper Cotter will offer our invocation.
Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for all we have and that we're all able to gather here today and that we be able to have a good Easter. And please us that we will be kind today and please us all the people who are not able to make it and that they can be watched over. Please us all the people in need and that they can get better and know that Jesus is watching over them. And please us the missionaries that are in this world and more and that they can help other people join the Church of Jesus Christ. And please us that we can have a good Easter and know that Jesus is resurrected on this day and that we will remember that. And please us that we can be kind and have a good Sabbath day and know that Jesus is always with us and that he lives. And please us that we can have the Spirit with us today. And in the name of Christ, amen.
A couple more announcements. One, you probably all know this, but today is just a sacrament meeting. There'll be no meetings after for the typical second hour. Also, next Sunday is General Conference, and then it's the week after the State Conference. So please take note of that. We do have several items of ward business. We would like to, we've extended releases to the following individuals. Christina Lingenbrink as a primary activity leader, Paul Lingenbrink as a priest advisor, priest quorum advisor, and Jay Rock as a deacon's quorum advisor. All those who wish to join in expressing appreciation to these members for their service, please indicate by the uplifted hand. As the following names are read, we ask these individuals to please stand and remain standing while the vote is taken. It's proposed that we sustain Amanda Scouten as a ward missionary, Carter Scouten as a ward missionary, Jay Rock as a ward missionary, Christina Lingenbrink as a primary worker, Paul Lingenbrink as a primary worker, and Tiffany Kempton as a primary activity leader. All in favor, please manifest it. Any opposed by the same sign. We'll prepare for the sacrament by singing hymn number 193, which is I Stand All Amazed. And after that, the sacrament will be passed to the congregation.
Jesus. God, the eternal Father, we ask thee in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ, to bless and sanctify this bread to the souls of all those who partake of it, that they may eat in remembrance of the body of thy Son, and witness unto thee, O God, the eternal Father, that they are willing to take upon them the name of thy Son, and always remember him, and keep his commandments which he has given them, that they may always have his Spirit to be with them. Amen.
Thank you.
did not receive the sacrament? Well, it's a good thing there were four men up here, so we could make sure that all went well. I'm really looking forward to our program today. We'll start by hearing from Hazel Smith, one of our newest beehives. She'll be followed by Suzanne Morris. And then we'll have a special musical number from the Ward Choir, and Dave Morris will be our concluding speaker. We'll proceed to that point.
Hi everyone. For those that do not know who I am, my name is Hazel Smith. I'm excited to speak today, especially because it is Easter. I hope that everyone is having a great Easter so far. I know I am. Every year for Easter, it is a tradition for my family to go to the Easter pageant. This year at the Easter pageant, one of my favorite parts was when the apostles were on the ship in the middle of the raging storm. I thought it was cool when the apostles saw Jesus walking on the water and Peter asked if he could come to him. Jesus responded and said to him, "Come." Peter got out of the boat and began to walk to Jesus. When he looked around and saw how big the storm was, he got nervous and began to sink. And this is where things got a little weird. I know how the story goes. Jesus reaches in and pulls him out of the water, right? I kept expecting him to reach in and save Peter, but he just stood there watching him drown. Finally, he did reach in and pull him out. Side note, I was able to go to the Easter pageant again. This time I timed it. 42 seconds underwater in the raging storm. 42 seconds. Luckily, he was still alive. Of course, we know that is not how it actually happened. The Bible says that Jesus immediately reached for Peter to save him. Jesus reached for him without hesitation. Like Peter, we often step out in faith, only to find ourselves in the middle of life's storms. And exactly in these moments, when we have doubt and fear that the Savior's love is the brightest. He does not just stand by and wait for us to solve our problems alone. Instead, he reaches out his hand to save us the moment we call out to him. President Russell M. Nelson spoke about the Savior's incredible ability to save us, saying, "Jesus Christ loves us. He saves us from sin and death. For that, he is literally our Savior and Redeemer." The prophet, President Thomas S. Monson, once said, "We must develop the faith to listen and obey the whisperings of the Holy Spirit. It is our faith in Jesus Christ that will allow us to find peace in the middle of scary storms that are all around us. In the moments that we feel like we are sinking, it will be the Savior who reaches out to help us. His atonement is not just for our sins, but also for our pains, our suffering, our fear, and our sadness. He loves us. I just want to bear my testimony, and I know that the Savior is always there for us. I know that he knows me individually, and that he loves me, and that he died to save me from sin and fear and sadness. I'm grateful that during this Easter season, we think about him and talk about him. I know these things are true. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen."
Well, happy, glorious Easter, everyone. The Lord has risen, and I stand all amazed. I'm deeply grateful and humbled for this opportunity to speak to you this morning. Hazel, she's delightful, and that was such a sweet and perfect message for this morning, so I appreciate that. There is a lot of you this morning. Wow. I'm just going to dive right in. Ezra Taft Benson said that men and women will not accept the atonement until they accept and understand the doctrine of the fall. So I heard this a couple weeks ago, and I just couldn't let it go. So I want to spend a little bit of time on that this morning. But here's my disclaimer. There are books written on the doctrine of the fall. So the thoughts I'll be sharing with you will be condensed to about 5 minutes. So this is by no means any complete breakdown of the fall. But I hope that I can share something or say something that can help us better appreciate what Jesus Christ did for us. In the words of President Nelson, mortality and death came into the world through the fall of Adam. Immortality and the possibility of eternal life were provided by the atonement of Jesus Christ. The creation, the fall, and the atonement were planned long before the actual work of creation began. And I love this. I just feel like we are in really good hands. So what is God's plan? We don't know a lot about our premortal lives, but we do know a few things. We know there was a council in heaven where God presented his plan for our progress and eternal happiness. This plan preserved the precious gift of moral agency, and I'll speak on that in just a moment. It's recorded in Job chapter 38, verse 7, that the morning stars sang together, and all the sons and daughters of God shouted for joy. Doesn't this indicate that we longed for this opportunity of progress that God presented? Our rejoicing was immediate. We wanted to take this next step, an eternal progression, with all of its inherent risks and hard work and faith that we knew it would require of us. Elder Uchtdorf, borrowing a famous phrase from The Hobbit, said, "We agreed to leave the security of our first estate and embark on our own great adventure there and back again." This plan of there and back again, or plan of happiness, required for there to be certain conditions. Before Adam and Eve partook of the fruit in the garden, they could walk and talk in the presence of God, and they were immortal. These were positive conditions. The negative conditions were, one, they were innocent, and 2 Nephi chapter 2, verse 22 and 23 explains why this is a negative condition. In their innocence, they would have had no joy. For they knew no misery, doing no good, for they knew no sin. The second negative condition, they were unable to bear children, so they would not have joy in their posterity. So the fall essentially reverses these conditions. Adam and Eve were cut off from God, the Father, and were no longer immortal. The fall also caused an orderly world to become chaotic and disorderly. Elder Gong says of earth life, mortal life is disorderly, seemingly unjust and unfair. The natural physical order of a fallen world, along with the consequences of human myopia, imperfection, callousness, selfishness, and greed, can lead to chronic hunger, disease, trauma, abuse, violence, exploitation, degrading treatment, and challenging circumstances. So God essentially created the earth so things would go wrong. Why would he do this? In 2 Nephi chapter 2, verse 11, we learn, "For it must needs be that there is an opposition in all things. If not, righteousness could not be brought to pass, neither wickedness, neither holiness nor misery, neither good nor bad." If there were no problems, if there was no opposition, no challenging circumstances, it would be impossible for us to learn and grow and progress and become like our Savior. Elder Christofferson taught that for us to have agency, we must not only have alternatives, but we must also know what they are. Otherwise, the existence of those choices is meaningless to us. Because of the fall, we have sufficient knowledge and understanding to be enticed by good and evil. We attain a state of accountability. We don't always love this, and can recognize the alternatives before us. It's not easy. I'm so fascinated by the story of the Israelites who were led out of Egypt. Moses led the Israelites out of slavery, out of Egypt, but they struggled. They struggled with their newfound freedom. It was really hard. In fact, at one point, they even wanted to go back to Egypt, where they were enslaved. It's the same with us, right? Sometimes we want to escape the responsibility of moral agency, or we want to convince ourselves that we're not accountable. But Elder Bednar makes it clear that the process of proving ourselves, as hard as it may be, is a fundamental part of Heavenly Father's plan. Okay, so let's get to the good news. The fall was essential because it created the exact conditions that we needed to progress and prove ourselves. But it would have cut us off from God forever, and we would have died in our sins, having no way to progress or return back to our heavenly home without a Savior. But we do have a Savior. An atonement was made by him for each and every one of us. Maybe one of my scriptorians up here could help me. As I was sitting down there, I thought of the scripture, "Men are that they might have joy." So I wanted to make sure I just was talking about kind of the human condition and the fall and the difficulty of that. But we know that men are that they might have joy. And might is the key word, and Jesus Christ is the answer. And I think it's in 2 Nephi. 2 Nephi 2:25. I knew they would know this. Okay. John 3:16. So now I want to get into the good news. John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." This is what Christ says to us in John 16, verse 33. "These things I've spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Now the world hits us in a lot of different ways. And I want to share a couple experiences of how the world hit me kind of early in my life. And just so you know, I am happy. I'm going to share these experiences, but I'm good. But every time I share them, I just get a little emotional. So at 24 years old, Dave and I were expecting our first baby. And I think I've even shared this in a testimony, but we were expecting our first baby. We were expecting a daughter. And we were so excited. Sorry. But there was a complication in my 33rd week. And my daughter's heartbeat stopped. And I had to deliver her stillborn. And at that young age of 24, it was a loss that I had never experienced before. It was devastating. And I was heartbroken, and I was grieving. And yet, in that adversity, Christ made a triumphal entry into my life. And I experienced him in a very real way. Two years later, my dad died from cancer. I was 26 and I was nervously expecting my second baby. And I was feeling pretty certain that God would preserve my father's life. I couldn't imagine life without my dad. So it was a painful thought. But cancer did take his life. And I was not blessed with the outcome I had prayed for. And neither was my mom or my siblings. But I know, and I can speak for all my siblings and my mom, who were gathered together in our home that day that he died, that there was a thinning of the veil. The Spirit was palpable, and we were each blessed and sustained in very personal ways. My youngest brother was in Puerto Rico serving his mission when my father died. And after his mission president delivered what would have been shocking and surprising news, he said, "I was crying and praying when that sickening feeling of loss was removed as I felt a literal blanket of warmth surround my body. In that moment, I felt as though the Savior himself had thrown his arms around me." I just want to close with my testimony. I don't know everything, but I do know that Jesus Christ lives, and I know that he is my Savior and my Redeemer. We do need to learn how to choose. And I know that Jesus Christ will help us in the process of growing and progressing and proving ourselves. This is why we're here this morning, to celebrate him. I have a testimony of covenants and the power of God that comes into our lives through those covenants, through our covenant relationship with God and families. And I leave these things with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
If you're like me, you came here this Easter morning to be filled with a brightness of hope and a love of God. And perhaps now you're also maybe considering some of the trials of your life and recognizing that it was in those very moments that Christ made a triumphant entry into your heart. Or maybe you're going through it right now and you're considering, should I now allow Christ to make a triumphant entry into my heart, into my life, so that he can lead me, guide me, and walk beside me? I'm never going to forget now, Hazel, thinking about Peter and his struggle and the timing with that. And then I love that Suzanne then explained why maybe sometimes we are allowed to struggle in this life, and that Jesus Christ makes it possible for us to be healed and come through. And each time I considered this moment with us together this Easter morning, I pictured that glorious Easter morning with our Savior Jesus Christ and Mary together. I pictured him with the sun illuminating his resurrected body behind him. And then I always pictured Mary's face, the intense, perfect love that they must have had for each other as they looked at each other. And then the classic phrase, "He is risen." He is risen. Every time I think of that, there's a brightness of hope, and I feel the love that I have for him and he has for me. I would then picture the apostles of Christ at the time of Christ, and for some reason they're always running to greet each other and share the good news that he's risen. And it's maybe just me, but I picture the actors of The Chosen, and maybe that is just me. But if you will, with me for a moment, picture them running to each other, greeting each other, grabbing each other's arms and shoulders with giant smiles on their faces and looking each other in the eye. He is risen. President Nelson said that under the Father's great eternal plan, it is the Savior who suffered. It is the Savior who broke the bands of death. It is the Savior who paid the price for our sins and transgressions and blots them out on condition of our repentance. It is the Savior who delivers us from physical and spiritual death. And as we build our life story, Elder Gong explained, much of our external physical environment may change. That which matters most spiritually does not change. And as the prophet Alma declared, there is one thing which is of more importance than they all. Of all the many things that beckon for our attention, that which ultimately matters most does not change. Who we are spiritually, our spiritual identity, those we are, covenant belonging, and how we use our God-given agency to discover and become our own best story. This morning we celebrate the miracle that makes this all possible. Jesus is the center of God's plan. And now in our remaining few minutes, I hope to kind of expand on this, and I wish to build on this in the vein of connection and transformation, with the hope that we all leave this room today feeling an extra level of energy to take on and a connected love of our Savior Jesus Christ as we take on all the challenges that we face in this mortal life. And as we step out those doors this day and pick back up those challenges that can be heavy and sometimes feel too heavy, that we'll be ready to do this and we'll have that abundance and brightness of hope and a love of God, because we know we will not be alone. Our Savior will be with us. Because I know that you'll be with me. Because I want to be transformed by you. Because I believe in your plan, and because I believe that your plan is always better than my own. Because before I was born, I chose to choose to have this experience, and I want to become. And you chose, Lord, to suffer, to bleed, and to die for my sins and my sorrows and my shortcomings, my insecurities, my pain, not only so that I could be forgiven, redeemed, cleansed, healed, but perhaps also so that you could understand exactly how I feel going through it all, and so that you could meet me wherever I am, wherever that is. Elder Holland said, speaking of how powerful and far-reaching the atonement of Christ is, however many chances you think you have missed, however many mistakes you feel you have made, or talents you think you don't have, or however far from home and family and God you feel you have traveled, I testify that you have not traveled beyond the reach of divine love. It is not possible for you to sink lower than the infinite light of Christ's atonement shines. Close quote. That promise gives me hope. It's no wonder that the atonement and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the greatest connecting force of all time. At a macro level, it makes the plan of salvation, the purpose to life, work. At a micro level, he understands and can connect with me and you personally and know even exactly how we feel. No matter what you've done or sins you're currently struggling with, our Savior is holding yours and my hand and has said, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And I pray that right now we can feel God's love and we can all have a little bit of rest from the world. And as we step forward, connected with our Savior, accessing power through him in our darkest hours and also our best of days, do we not want to journey this mortal life together with our brothers and sisters and with each other? Can we get excited to transform, to renew and open new life chapters with him? See what's possible with each other, the body of Christ? And what about our relatives, both dead and to come? Alma taught us so well, capturing Abinadi's final words. And if Christ has not risen from the dead or have broken the bands of death, that the grave should have no victory and that death should have no sting, there could have been no resurrection. But there is a resurrection. Therefore, the grave hath no victory and the sting of death is swallowed up in Christ. He is the light and the life of the world. Yea, a light that is endless, that can never be darkened. Yea, and also a life which is endless, and there can be no more death. Even this mortal shall put on immortality, and this corruption shall put on incorruption. As Suzanne and I think about Kelly and Suzanne, her dad, and I know many of you have dealt with loss, some very recently, the resurrection of Jesus Christ doesn't take away the pain, but it does give us a brightness of hope. Easter Sunday today, we celebrate Jesus Christ overcoming sin and death. The morning after that he arose after 3 days in the tomb, alive in a resurrected body. He would show himself to many people. He'd break bread, eat with the apostles. He visited the people there. He visited many people, multitudes here in America and places all over the world. I imagine many, many people wept. As I think about that scenario and what that might be like if I were there, would tears come to my eyes because this Jesus Christ who had been prophesied about is actually real and that I was there in his presence? Or would I weep because his sacrifice is personal for me? Perhaps also because I knew that I was a part of his pain. And should I feel guilty for that, or should I just feel grateful? Maybe both. Probably all of these reasons would bring tears to my eyes, and as I ponder this setting, what then fills my heart is his immense love for each and every one of us. President Nelson said this atonement was for all generations, those sons and daughters of God before and who would come after. Yes, all of us, every one of us. The good news of that day is the greatest news of today and is the greatest news of tomorrow, all the way through to when Jesus returns in body again the morning of the first resurrection. The plan is real. The fall is real. The mission, the atonement and resurrection of Jesus Christ is real. The scriptures and prophets today testify of these real and eternal truths. And as we ponder these sacred events, we're reminded of each Easter, as we partake of the sacrament, the bread and the water, the emblems of his body and blood each week, the Holy Spirit of promise, the Spirit of truth, the Comforter, The Spirit that Jesus testified would come and testify of him testifies to us each week that the atonement of Jesus Christ is true. Today, will we choose to connect with our Savior at a deeper and holier level? As we write the next chapter of our lives, will we write that next chapter with him? And as we choose to bring him into our heart, will we not want to extend this same love to each other? As we leave these doors this day, each now with a greater understanding of the personal connection that we have with our Savior and an extra portion of love for each other, can we leave with a greater energy to face the struggles and challenges of this mortal life, knowing that we're not alone? Will I carry with me a brightness of hope, a love of God and my fellow man? Will I be willing to have faith in Jesus Christ to grow in my next life chapter? I'd like to echo in closing an invitation made by Elder Holland. If you've made covenants, keep them. If you haven't made them, make them. If you've made them and broken them, repent and repair them. It is never too late, so long as the master of the vineyard says there is time. Please listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit telling you right now, this very moment, that you should accept the atoning gift of the Lord Jesus Christ and enjoy the fellowship of his labor. Don't delay. Close quote. It is my prayer on this special Easter morning that each of us will feel the always burning love and understanding of our Savior Jesus Christ, that we will come unto him, always remember him, always remember that we are sons and daughters of a loving God who overcame physical death, that paid the price for our sins upon our repentance with an infinite and eternal sacrifice of the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. This is my humble prayer for us as a body of Christ, and I say these things with gratitude for yours and my Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Awesome Easter program today. It's so amazing to get together once a year to commemorate the resurrection of Christ. We will close today by singing hymn number 199, He is Risen, and Bryce Baker will offer our benediction.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this wonderful Easter morning that we're able to meet together as a ward family and feel of thy Spirit. We're so grateful for thee and our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the atonement that he's performed for us. We're grateful for the speakers and for the choir for their preparations. And we say, sing the name of Christ, amen.